Hi, everybody. I'm Geraldo Rivera, and behind me is the courthouse in Santa Maria, California, with Michael Jackson, one of the most significant entertainers of the last half century. One of the most well-known and controversial people in the world is in the fight of his life. If convicted on all 10 counts, which range from child molesting to giving alcohol to a minor, he would face more than 20 years behind bars, the end of his career, and the loss of his three children. Because of a court-imposed gag order, Michael is prohibited from speaking about the case. But because of a recent leak of damning, supposedly secret grand jury transcripts, after a hearing on Tuesday, January 18th, Judge Rodney Melville agreed to allow the defendant to speak in general terms about the allegations against him so unfairly made public by the grand jury leak. So at the end of our interview, Michael will be making a statement about the charges currently pending against him in Judge Melville's court. After investigating the facts and circumstances in this case, I have made no secret of my feelings, however unpopular. It is my constitutionally protected opinion that Michael Jackson is not guilty of these charges, and I've said so often and in no uncertain terms. And I believe that as this case unfolds, many of you will come to agree with me. Before we meet the beleaguered king of pop, we begin at the scene of the alleged crime. Sadly for Michael Jackson, Neverland Ranch, this fantasy world he created back in 1988 to celebrate his vision of himself as a kind of modern-day Peter Pan, has too often been sullied by harsh reality. 12 years ago, when the King of Pop was performing overseas, this 2,800-acre spread in a remote section of Santa Barbara County was raided for the first time. Since then, law enforcement officials have often come bursting through these lovely gates. Sometimes, the defense argues, they've come just to make a point, and perhaps also to make some news. Example, the widely covered December 3rd raid to obtain a sample of Michael's DNA, a sample they obtained without any hoopla at all in private the very next day. In the words of one legal pundit, Neverland has been searched more often than the Pakistan-Afghanistan border. Neverland is as unique as the man who built it, a shrine celebrating an innocent ideal that over the years has been crushed and sullied by allegation, rumor, and innuendo. Now, as the current case against him unfolds, Michael Jackson knows for a certainty that the district attorney will spin every child-friendly attraction, from the statues, to the rides, to the exotic animals, into a kind of malevolent child trap. And this despite the fact that over the years, thousands of mostly inner-city children have enjoyed this place without incident. Yet he knows that what you see in this place, innocence or evil, is in the eye of the beholder. Our interview was conducted at a friend's recording studio on the 19th of January. Here it begins.
So how you doing?
I'm doing fine, Geraldo. How are you?
Despite whatever goes on in the world, you feel okay?
I'm doing very well, thank you.
You know, it's wonderful seeing you with the children. That, I think, is the real Michael Jackson that has not been seeing you with your own children, one in diapers, the other two toddlers. I don't know how you manage without a nanny.
Well, I enjoy taking care of my children myself. It's fun. That's why I had them, so I could take care of them. And it's great relief for me. You know, it's pleasure. It keeps me happy and laughing. And they're wonderful, sweet, innocent children. They really are.
I saw you as kind of the arbitrator between the Nickelodeon channel and the Disney channel there. That was
yeah, you noticed.
You get some really difficult problems to solve there.
Yes.
But you have such a kind of a normal life there. It's sweet to see.
Thank you.
But
they bring me that, you know. Yeah,
tell me what the children mean to you, your own children.
They mean, it's hard to put it in words because they mean everything, the way you would explain how your children make you feel. I mean, they're the world for me. I mean, I wake up and I'm ready for the day because of them. I give them breakfast, I change diapers. If they want to read, we do a lot of reading. We play hide and seek, we play blindfold, and I have a wonderful time with them.
And you can create a world that at least begins to seem normal. I mean, they don't know any other world, obviously, but.
I do my best, for sure.
So that is obviously a priority to you?
Yes, of course. I want to be the best father in the world, of course.
Do they know who you are or what you mean to people?
Yes, they do. They've been on tours with me and in limousines and among sea of fans. And
do they like it?
They find it exciting. They do. They want to get on stage. They bug me to go on stage with me, so pretty soon I'm going to take them on with me. Let the world see them for the first time.
They don't say, Daddy, I want to go home and watch Nickelodeon?
Probably.
They do that too?
Yes.
So how do you feel being here in a recording studio again, focusing on the music again? Is it a relief in a sense?
It's a great relief because it's what I do, and it makes me feel like I'm totally at home. I'm into my own. This is what I'm here for, and any of the arts like that could be film, music, you know, any type of art. I love it.
So when you're being the quote-unquote king of pop, that's when you're most comfortable?
I don't know.
Or is it the creative process?
The creative process, yes. I love creating. I love it. I'm obsessed with creating. I love it.
I saw you and Randy, the way you guys react. It's very reminiscent of the way my brothers and I are together.
Yes.
Who's top dog?
Randy.
Yeah. That's not what I saw. But you trust your family.
Of course.
And that's,
you have to.
Is it blood thicker than water thing? What is that?
Yeah, and family is everything to us. I mean, it's love. It's what we were taught, and values, and we're friends at the end of the day, which is important. Other than what the public or press people say, we're friends. We love each other very much.
So is the family still closely knit despite all the kind of tabloid stuff over
the
years?
That's sensationalism.
How do you deal with that?
How do I deal with sensationalism?
Yeah, how do you deal with everything in your life being magnified, exaggerated?
It's not true.
Almost to a grotesque
It's like looking at a fictitious movie because it's fiction. It's like watching science fiction. It's not true. And I know myself. And it's sad when other people have to read those things and they believe it.
But do you feel like holding a press conference every week and saying, well, this is the rumor du jour. That's not true.
No, because I know eventually the truth will prevail. And I'm about truth, you know?
I've researched it, and I can't find anyone who's been more frivolously sued than you for the most outrageous reasons. One of your attorneys told me that a woman called Billie Jean Jackson called and said, stop accepting any paychecks, Mr. Attorney. I'm the wife, and I'm Billie Jean, taking it obviously from your hit song.
Yes.
I mean, first of all, does it affect you, the rumors?
Does it affect me?
Yeah.
Yes, but I become immune in a way, too. I'm very strong. I have rhinoceros skin, but at the same time, I'm human, you know, so anything can hurt like that, you know, but I'm very strong. And I just don't like people hearing about such false information.
For instance, did you father quadruplets last year?
There was a crazy rumor.
Then they became twins, I know. I don't know what happened to the other two. Maybe they were abducted by aliens.
Yeah, I heard about that story. No, I don't have any twins. And they said I'm hiding them or something. No, it's come another made-up rumor.
So it's completely false.
Yeah, I think the bigger the star, the bigger the target. I'm not trying to say I'm the super-duper star. I'm not saying that. I'm saying, you know, the fact that people come at celebrity. We're targets. But truth always prevails, and I believe in that. I believe in God, you know?
Does that faith sustain you?
Of course it does.
How about friendship?
What about friendship?
Do you rely on friends? Have people stayed with you through thick and thin? Who are your best friends?
My children and my family, my brothers and my sisters, and yeah, most people have. Most people have.
Do you want to mention the names of the True Blue?
The faithful, you would know them, so it's...
Elizabeth Taylor?
Well, she's very loyal. I see Elizabeth all the time, and she's my dear friend. I was just at her house. We have wonderful talks on the phone at night, several times a week sometime.
So how long have you two been friends?
I've known Elizabeth closely since I was 16, yeah.
And you've been making music since you were 5?
Yes.
So you're in your 5th decade. That's 41 years of making music.
Yes.
You ever get sick of it?
No. No, not at all. I never get enough of it.
Really?
Really.
Do you ever get sick of Randy?
Never.
He's here, Liz, yo. That's right.
Never. He's wonderful. He's been very supportive and amazingly brilliant, really.
They're all different. Your whole family is
every
crazy,
brother
eccentric,
and sister is
like
completely different. Like any family, you know, you have all the different elements, and everybody's different. That's what makes it a family.
When you have such intense scrutiny, how do you live any kind of normal life? How do you, you know, have any fun outside of your own property?
I don't. I go off property sometime, but not all the time. I create my world behind the gates, you know, because I can't go to the local movie theater down the street or the local park down the street or go pick up ice cream at the market, at the corner store. So you want to create that world behind the gates. And that's what I try and do. And it's not just for me if I could share with my family or friends or whoever I do. No?
And that necessity for some privacy drives all these crazy rumors and speculation. So it's a difficult balancing act that you have to endure.
Yes, yes. It's part of what comes with celebrity. You know?
But you're not complaining, are you? I don't. I try to, you know, rub it off. Not that I'm the, I don't know what I'm the king of. King of getting shot at, maybe.
No. King of journalism.
So what is it about children in distress? You mentioned the tsunami relief effort.
Yes.
What is it? Is it your own fatherhood that motivates that?
Caring and reading the Bible, learning about God, Jesus, love. Jesus said, bring on the children, imitate children, you know, be like little children, and to take care of others, to take care of old people. And we were raised with those values. Those are very important values, and my family and I, we were raised with those values, and they continue strong in us today.
When we come back, Jackson talks about a musical reunion with his brothers for a wonderful cause. That is after this.
We're family. That's what we are. And my mother is strong, my father's strong. We're even stronger together. But we didn't know that from those humble beginnings, the success would bring about this.
You know, I've taken firm and very public positions on every major case from O.J. Simpson to the Clinton impeachment, but none has generated the negative attention of this one. In a spirited exchange last night with Jay Leno on The Tonight Show, I figured out why. It's that every one of us has formed an indelible image of Michael Jackson over the years. It's one forged by events as far-ranging as the defendant's plastic surgeries, to the changing skin color, to what some consider his bizarre public or private behavior. As I said to my friend Jay Leno last night, none of that is relevant to the question of whether or not he molested the boy. In this relatively short segment, Jackson talks about what's ahead for him professionally, assuming, as I do, that he beats this case.
What about movies for yourself again?
Dorothy and Toto. What intelligent names.
You had The Wiz and some of the others, but we haven't seen you on the big screen in a while.
It's because I'll be directing myself. I love directing. I love creativity. And I think when an artist steps forward with a production of some type, if he can express himself the way he see it should be done, I mean, I feel it and I see it. I'm a visionary. So if I can give that, I do. And that's what I love to do with music, with film, with dance, with I love the arts.
And do you think art has a role in real life? And I'm specifically referring to this record and tsunami relief.
Yes.
You're doing this song for tsunami relief. Tell us the moment you recognized that this disaster was so extraordinary.
I saw it the day after, I think it was, after Christmas. And as the numbers kept building and escalating, it just became phenomenal. And not even I could believe that it was true. I was amazed. I said, I feel I should do something. That's what God gave us talent for, to give and to help people and to give back. And so my brothers and I decided to put a song together.
Would you pick up the phone and say, hey, bros?
Yeah,
let's
Randy
get together
and myself,
again?
Yeah. You say, hey, we want to do something in the studio for the tsunami victims, and let's get together. And they'll say, great, let's do it, you know, and we'll organize it.
However you're back, I think people will appreciate the fact that you're back. Wouldn't you kind of exult in a world where you could concentrate on your art and your kids? And
I would love it. I mean, that's what drives me, is the medium, this the art. I love it. And that's the world I'm most comfortable in.
Oh, baby, give me one more chance.
In Gary, Indiana, did you ever expect where your world would be as a 46-year-old man?
I never thought about it, really. I never thought about it. I knew I wanted to do something wonderful all my life and to help people, and but I never really clearly thought about it when I was really little. I just sang and danced and didn't understand why people were applauding and clapping and screaming, and you really don't. You don't know what, why.
When you grow up like that on stage, when do you get it? When do you understand where you fit into society?
I think it takes longer when you get older. You start to have a more rounded personality, and your brain starts to grow. You start reasoning and understanding more things and researching, and, you know. That's how it happened for me.
Isn't it nice to have a conversation on television where people can hear you just being ordinary, normal, reasonable?
I'm like this all the time. I'm just being myself. Well, God bless you. Thank you.
At a certain point, Michael Jackson and the brothers Jackson kind of separated artistically. Is this a moment in your life where you're coming back together? We obviously you'll continue your solo career, but what's the big plan? What's the big picture at this stage in your life? What has been left unachieved? What would you like to do?
There are a lot of surprises. Film. I love film.
What else?
Well, it's not just so much film, but it's innovating it and pioneering it, taking the medium to a new place.
I think we should just beat it.
Chris, stop worrying and just follow me.
I got this.
This girl is
Chris,
dangerous.
You're not talking about music videos now.
No, no.
Something else.
Because I use the music video medium as a short film medium to take me to the next level. And I'm having a lot of fun, you know?
I know who you are. Bing bang.
In the upcoming segment, Michael talks about his dad and the future of his music.
I think all these guys just put a lot of things in their magazines in order to sell the magazine.
I have no doubt that there is a commercial motivation,
yeah.
Some of it. But is all this stuff just smoke? There's no fire there?
It's smoke. You can see the smoke. Just observe depression, that's all.
Welcome back. This segment begins with Michael's assessment of where he fits in the current music scene. Watch.
Do you ever look back and contemplate, my goodness, Thriller is the biggest selling musical performance ever? Do you ever get your arms around that?
I think about it sometimes, but I try not to think about it too hard because I don't want my subconscious mind to think, like, I've done it all, you're done now. And no, there's so much, that's why I don't put awards or trophies in my house. You won't find a gold record anywhere in my house because it makes you feel you've accomplished. Look what I've done. But I always want to feel, no, I haven't done it yet.
The King of Pop. And now I look at, some of these performers. There's 50 Cent, and there's another one, I forget his name, but they're well known because they survived, you know, violent attacks where they almost died, mm-hmm. And they're into hip-hop kind of, it's a different era now in popular music. Do you think that you'll be more like them, more urban kind of, or do you think the world will come back to more pop and traditional rock?
Great music. And great melodies are immortal. I don't care, fashion change, culture changes, customs change. Great music is immortal. We still listen to Mozart today, Tchaikovsky, Rachmaninoff, any of the greats. Great music is like a great piece of sculpture or a great painting. It's forever, for generations upon generations to appreciate forever, really. And that's I know that's a fact.
On the other hand, I interviewed Barbara Streisand at one pivotal point in her career. She was going to do duets with the Bee Gees and other popular artists. She really kind of changed the tempo to surprise people. Would you ever consider more of a hip-hop approach?
I've done a lot of it, in my true opinion.
But
sure.
I mean, kind of rappy.
Where I rap?
You want to rap?
No,
that?
I
you know, give me an example.
I don't really rap, but I could rap.
I'm Michael Jackson. I want to say you.
I've written songs with rap verses in them for very famous rappers, but they're much better at it than I am. That's why I won't compete with them.
Don't you appreciate, despite your isolated life and despite the fact you've been a star so long, you still have what appears to be a very profound and passionate relationship with the community?
Welcome to Neverland.
Hey!
And Merry Christmas, and have a wonderful day, okay?
Thank you!
Does that support you? Does that sustain you? Do you agree with me?
Yes, I do agree, because it's important to love your neighbors.
But where does it come from? Where does that almost instinctive love of you come from? What do you think?
I truly think it comes from my mother and God, and the way we were raised and the values my father instilled in us as youth. And she was always there with the Bible, teaching us. We'd go to, you know, service all the time, like 4 times a week. I'm so glad we did that, because those values are very important. I don't know if I could have done as well without them.
Do you still spend time with Mom and Dad?
Yes, of course.
They're not far from here right now.
That's right.
And what is that relationship all about? I'm so close to my mom, obviously.
It's wonderful, actually. At this season in our lives, at this stage, I think you tend to appreciate who your parents are more and what they've done for you. You almost start to retract everything and where you are in your life and all the wonderful things they instilled in you. You start to see them come forth to take fruition in your life. And I'm starting to, you know, see a lot of things, traits that my father influenced me on and my mother, and so it's been amazing.
My friend Cheech, who you know, whose partner Tommy Chong helped discover you guys.
Yeah, I like that guy.
Bobby Taylor
of
the Vancouver's. Yeah. He says as he gets older, he looks at his father's face in the mirror. Do you feel that? Are you becoming like your dad, or do you see
him? I'm very much like my father in a lot of ways.
Tell us.
He's very strong. He's a warrior. He's always taught us to be courageous and to be confident and to believe in our ideals, and no matter what, no star is too far to reach, and you never give up. And our mother taught us that as well, no matter what.
So you're a warrior also?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's the way you see yourself?
Absolutely.
But tell us more about how you see yourself.
How I see myself?
Yeah.
You have to tell me. No. I try to be kind and generous and to people and to do what I think God wants me to do. Sometimes I pray and I say, where do you want me to go next, God? What do I do from here? So I'm very spiritual in that way. I always have been, though. It's nothing new.
I'm joined here at the Santa Maria Courthouse with Ramon Bain, Michael Jackson's spokesperson. Hi, Ramon.
Hi, Gerardo.
How did the first week in court go?
Well, it went very well. I mean, it was a long, tiring week for us. And we were all laughing today because just to think this is just the first week and we're a little tired. But I think the first week went very well.
What do you think of, tell me why, first of all, the jury selection is postponed tomorrow?
Well,
or Monday.
Regrettably, our lead counsel, Tom Mesereau, his sister is very ill, and he has taken some time to be with his family, and we'd like to send our prayers out to Tom. He's a wonderful person.
So we'll recommence on Thursday?
Yes, right now, next Thursday.
How's Michael faring?
Michael is doing well. This was a very busy week for him, tiring week, but he was very focused, very business, and it seemed like there were so many people surprised about that.
How focused he was?
Yes, and it amazes me sometimes, because I think people, they tend to believe what they read and they have these misconceptions, and he was about business. In fact, he's been very hands-on with his defense.
I think he should be. Much more with Ramon coming up. And coming up, Michael in Neverland. Stand by. Be right back.
On stage since the age of 5, a worldwide star since the age of 12, Michael Jackson has enjoyed one of the most remarkable careers in show business. In commercial terms, right up there with Sinatra. Presley, and the Beatles. His album, Thriller, the winner of 7 Grammy Awards, was still selling 1 million copies a year, 15 years after its release. But at the very peak of his career, Michael's legal problems have too often driven him into seclusion, a physical isolation, usually here at Neverland, that, if anything, has made him more vulnerable to attacks. He's offered us a tour of his house. For all its grandeur, as you'll see, Neverland is, in its way, a modest place, a place that celebrates children.
Perhaps Jackson's biggest problem is that his vision of himself as a kind of modern-day Peter Pan just does not sit well in a society scarred by stories of abusive priests and teachers and Boy Scout leaders. So in this segment, we talk about the original creator of Neverland.
You can visit Neverland anytime you like.
How?
Just believe.
Did you ever see the movie Finding Neverland or read about James Barry, the man who wrote Peter Pan?
I know a lot about Mr. Barry. I shouldn't say a lot, but I've always appreciated Mr. Barry's work, and I've been a fan of Mr. Barry for many, many, many years.
You know, he had a rocky road similar to you. I don't want to get too far into it, but tell us what led to the creation of Neverland. I mean, specifically the place. There's 2 Neverlands. There's 3. There's the Peter Pan's Neverland, there's the Neverland in Michael Jackson's mind, and then there's the physical place that you created up there that I visited you when you brought up all the inner city children. Why did you create that place?
I created Neverland as a home for myself and my children. And it was created simply, it was almost as it was done subconsciously. Like I said earlier, where can I go? I mean, it's hard. I've tried to go as myself, and I've had policemen actually tell me, put on a disguise and give me an autograph from my wife, whatever. But they tell me, why are you out here like this with no security? So, and there's like fans everywhere, so I can't do it. I do it sometime, but it's very difficult.
But you owned Neverland before you had the kids. Was it for you or the exotic animals? Were they for Michael Jackson, the child?
Oh, for me.
Yeah.
And for sharing
with
others.
Your own youthful spirit.
For me and sharing with others, because it gave me a chance to do the things I never got to do when I was little. We couldn't go to the movie theaters. We couldn't go to Disneyland. We couldn't do all those fun things. We were on tour. We were working hard, you know, and we enjoyed it. We did enjoy it, but this allowed me to have a place behind the gates with the entire world. Everything that I love is there, you know?
You create, like Barry, this imaginary or imaginative world. Do you ever outgrow something like that, Michael? Do you ever, you know, think, oh, this is silly to have the llamas and the little choo-choo train and the ride?
It's calling God silly if you do that.
Tell me.
Because God made all things great and small. So that would be wrong. When other men have their Ferraris or they have their little, if it's an airplane or a helicopter or whatever they find, wherever they find their bliss. And my bliss is in giving and sharing and having simple, innocent fun.
Your homes, I mean, for all the grandeur of Neverland, your home is quite modest. It's,
yeah.
And your personal style, I don't see any bling, for instance.
There you go.
How come? How come you have a big diamond thing that says Michael?
Because I'm modest in that way. And if I had it on, I would probably give it away from the first kid who would walk up to me and say, wow, I like your necklace here. You can have it. Because when I was little, stars like Sammy Davis, Fred Astaire, you know, Gene Kelly. If I admired something they were wearing, if I simply said, God, I love that shirt you're wearing, they would give it to me. So I was taught that, you know, that's part of a show business trait, you know, to hand it over.
Despite the glare of the media attention, and even the day that I was there and you invited the inner city kids there, what's it like to have the kids there? Why do you do that? I wanted to ask you that question that day, but I pose it to you now.
Why?
Why do you, when you see those kids, tell me what's going on.
Because I think I've traveled the world over 8 times around the world, and I go to I do as many hospitals and orphanages as I do concerts. But of course, it's not covered. That's not why I do it for coverage. I do it because it's from my heart. And there are so many children in the cities who've never seen mountains
who haven't been on a carousel, who haven't petted a horse or a llama, who've never seen them. So when if I can open my gates, and those gates open, and that bliss, an explosion of screaming and laughter from the children, and they run past the bridge, they run on the rides, I say, thank you, God. I feel I won God's smile of approval, you know, because I'm doing something that brings joy and happiness to other people.
So you're close to your siblings?
Yes.
How does it affect you then when they get involved, like Janet's Super Bowl flap?
Oh, I can't speak for my sister, but...
Just tell me how you responded as a brother and as a viewer.
With love. Actually, I was looking right at it, and I didn't see it. I was at a friend of mine's house in La Jolla, Ron Burkle, and in a movie theater. It was huge on the screen. I didn't even see it. So I heard all this controversy the next day. I said, that's not true. I saw none of it, so...
Do you think the controversy was overblown? And
yes.
Do you think it's a Jackson-related phenomenon, or is it a testament to our time socially in this country?
Well, that's an interesting hypothesis, too. It's both. It's hard to answer, really. I'd rather not answer that one.
Okay. Did you call her and say, don't sweat the small stuff?
Yeah, something like that. Be strong. This too shall pass. Don't worry about it. You know, I've seen worse things. I said, Janet, I once, you're too young to remember, but I once watched the Oscars with David Niven on it, and a naked man came running across, streaking. Now, he didn't get there on his own. That was organized, but they didn't say much about that. I'll just say that much. That was live around the world.
Let me say,
The next day, it was a joke.
It was a joke. I think there is a Jackson component. I think there is...
You can say that.
Okay, I just did.
You can say it.
I did. Okay. I think it was exaggerated, and I think that the Jackson connection was part of the reason it was exaggerated.
Thank you, Ron.
So as you go forward in this record, what are we going to expect? I mean, they're going to hear this on the radio, and then people are going to send in their money, and it's going to go to these kids in the Indian Ocean region?
I would like that very much, very much.
Now, tell me how that act of largesse, that compassion, will make you feel. How do you, you know, they, you know, sometimes I feel better giving than receiving. I think it really is true.
It is true.
In my life.
Of course.
Explain
it's true.
The mechanics of that in your own life.
It's just an idea. I don't know if it's the psychology of it or what. I just love working hard on something, putting it together, sweating over it, and then sharing it with people and having them love it. And I always pray that they like it. And that's what gives me great satisfaction as an artist.
Back to Ramon Bain, Michael Jackson's spokesperson here outside the Santa Maria courthouse. Why do you think people are willing to believe the absolute worst about your client?
Well, I can't say that I agree with that, that they believe the absolute worst as a whole. For every one irate email I get, or an email of hatred, I get about 40 or 50 of support. So, you know, I think that it has to do with the fact that there has been so much thrown at us out here that we just have not been able to address because we have been under a very strict gag order.
Example.
Of which we're going to adhere to. For instance, the leaks, the transcripts. I mean, he had to go to court and get an approval from the judge. There have been so many other things. Smokinggun.com, they have so many things per week. We can't address them. So you have all of these stories and they compound daily. And I think people sometimes, I don't say that they want to believe it, but I think they get tired of it and they feel that, okay, if we're hearing it every day, there must be some truth to this.
Mm-hmm.
And a number of things we have been able to address, all of the various rumors. And I take my hat off to Michael because, goodness, we have had to really deal with quite a few things this past year. But as I said, you know, as we refer in politics, you know, there is a silent majority. And I think that on a whole, his supporters far outweigh those who don't support him. But as I've said, I think that it's just because we have not been able to get ahead of the curve in some of these issues.
Of all of the shots that Michael's taken in recent years, none seems to have affected him as much as the parody by the rapper Eminem. That's coming up. And one note, this entire program will be rebroadcast tomorrow night, Sunday night after the Super Bowl at 11 o'clock Eastern time. We'll be right back.
Love for a child. I'm sorry. It can't be measured. I love him dearly. I can't even sleep at night thinking about what these wicked people might try to do to him when I know he's in.
Hey, whether it's his old pet monkey or the time his hair caught on fire filming that Pepsi commercial, Michael Jackson's been the brunt of a million jokes in 100 languages. But of all of them, none has cut as deeply as the musical parody by the rapper Eminem. Here Michael talks about that, plus the image recently attached to him as a creative has been. Watch.
Does it frustrate you professionally or personally when people say that this Jackson project flopped or that happened? Your number one compilation, for instance, 7.5 million copies. Now, I think that's quadruple platinum or whatever it is that you label it, and yet the characterization by some in the music business, at least, is that you're not, well, you know, you're not, that it wasn't a hit. How do you feel about that?
Number one, I don't know which project you're talking about, but the
compilation, the last one. It was
compilation is over, it's a huge success.
7.5 million.
Yes, and that's that.
But how come that's not the headline? It's a huge success.
Exactly.
Why is the headline?
Because
negative
news, sensationalism seem to sell more than wonderful, positive news. And people rather hear gossip, I think, sometimes than the truth. And my last 8 albums have all entered the charts at number one, and so people like to sensationalize things and make up stories and rumors, and sometimes...
Does it hurt your feelings? Do you want to scream out and say, hey, wait a second, check the numbers?
It's a commonology in mankind that I don't like, that part of it, that kind of, you know, envy. But then there's a beautiful side to mankind, too, isn't it?
But not to Eminem. We've spoken about it. I think that you should. Why not?
Speak about what?
About Eminem and this disrespect that he showed you.
I'm gonna make you dance, get your chance. Yeah, boy, shake that thing. Oops, I mean girl.
Girl, you know you're my world.
All right, now lose it.
Stevie Wonder said that he was piling on and how really rude it was for someone who made his money from the community, as Eminem has, to now diss the community in a sense, and a racist, and I've said it, very bold-faced, bigoted kind of presentation. Tell us how that hurt you. And how you're feeling about it now?
I've never met Mr. Eminem, and to have him, I've always admired him, and to have him do something like that was pretty painful as an artist to another artist. And it's sad because, well, I think what Stevie Wonder said is true. And I just don't want to say too much more than that. But he should be ashamed of himself, what he's doing. Stevie said he's bullshit. That's what he said.
Stevie did.
He used the word.
He is bullshit.
That's what he said. I mean, I'm not saying it, but Stevie said it. And Stevie is he's amazing. He's one of the sweetest men in the world, you know.
So when Stevie said that, did you feel a tremendous sense of a reassurance of brotherly love there?
Yes, I love Stevie Wonder. To me, he's a musical prophet, and I always love him. But a lot of people respect Stevie, and he's a very strong entity in this medium, in this business. And when he speaks, people listen. And it was wrong of Eminem to do what he did. I've been an artist most of my life doing what I do, and I've never attacked another fellow artist. Great artists don't do that. You know, you don't have to do that.
I mentioned Janet's, you know, fiasco and the exaggerated response to it. Once again, do you think he only did it because he knew he could get away with it because you're Michael Jackson?
Yeah, but it doesn't hurt. Really, it's silly. It's kind of elementary, but I hope he's having fun.
It's like a poo-poo joke.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, it still hurts your feelings, and you don't want your kids to see it.
Oh God, I would hate it if they saw it. I would hate that.
Do you want them to know that?
To know about it? No.
Yeah.
When we come back, Michael addresses the charges pending against him here in Santa Maria. After this.
This programming note, aside from being repeated at 10 o'clock Pacific time tonight, this entire hour will also be rebroadcast tomorrow night following the Super Bowl at 11 o'clock Eastern, 8 o'clock Pacific time, Sunday night. Now, before Ramon and I offer some final thoughts, Michael addresses the very serious charges against him and that blatant grand jury leak that has poisoned the air around this case, even as the jury is being selected. Here's Michael.
Finally, you know, we studiously avoided the case. We've not talked at all about the case that's pending. You're under this gag order. I know that you have received the permission from the judge to read a statement.
Yes.
You know, I hate to end an interview that way, but if you'd like to read that statement now, I think it's important.
Sure. In the last 2 weeks, a large amount of ugly, malicious information has been released into the media about me. Apparently, this information was leaked through transcripts in a grand jury proceeding where neither my lawyers nor I ever appeared. The information is disgusting and false. Years ago, I allowed a family to visit and spend time in Neverland. Neverland is my home. I allowed this family into my home because they told me their son was ill with cancer and needed my help. Through the years, I helped thousands of children who were ill or in distress. These events have caused a nightmare for my family, my children, and me. I never intend to place myself in so vulnerable a position ever again. I love my community, and I have great faith in our justice system. Please keep an open mind and let me have my day in court. I deserve a fair trial like every other American citizen. I will be acquitted and vindicated when the truth is told.
Anything else you'd like to say?
No. Yes, there's something. I would love to have the public's prayers for my children and myself.
Okay, buddy, you got it.
All right.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Ramon Bain, Michael's spokesperson, final thoughts.
Well, let me just say this, Geraldo. Michael Jackson is a good man. And I know that we are going to go into this thing. He has a lot of confidence in his defense. He has the love of his family. And he has maintained his innocence. And I am just appealing to people to think twice about believing everything they read.
I have a few points also. Item, the family now accusing Michael Jackson once swore to L.A. County investigators that he had done nothing wrong. Item, they contacted a civil lawyer before they ever contacted the police. Item, it just so happened to be the same lawyer who wrought a multi-million-dollar settlement from Jackson years before. And item, all of the incidents in the indictment supposedly happened only after the airing of the damning documentaries against Michael Jackson. Those and many other items led me to conclude that he's being framed. But he's not without blame. To me, the biggest news in his statement is Michael's declaration that he will never place himself in so vulnerable a position as the one he created by allowing children to sleep over at his home. In other words, Michael has stopped attempting to defend what is, however innocent, culturally indefensible. It's now become obvious to Michael what should perhaps have been obvious all along, that in this often hard, sometimes cruel world, there is no Peter Pan. So how much time do I have remaining in the program? Okay. I want you folks to know that if you watch the Fox News channel, you're going to get a fair and balanced news coverage of the trial unfolding here. It will be historic. I think in many ways it will raise issues that will have resonance throughout our society. As Ramon has said, I urge everybody to keep an open mind. Listen to the evidence. And as you listen to the evidence, ask yourself whether or not it is convincing enough to convict a man beyond a reasonable doubt. You know, unless the district attorney in this case, Tom Seddon, has something much more than we have seen in either the grand jury or in the various leaks about his allegations, I think Michael Jackson will be vindicated. And what we hope, Ramon, is that he goes back to music, making the music that has given so much pleasure to so many millions of people. I know the family has their fingers crossed. And we'll certainly be watching.
Yeah, well, I think so many people out here are hoping that he comes back on stage because he's fantastic, and there's no other entertainer like Michael Jackson. He is in a class by himself.
We look forward to his tsunami relief
record being released, kind of a We Are the World too. We look forward to Michael and his brothers reuniting and going on their world tour. Ramon Bain, Michael Jackson's spokesperson, thank you very much for being with us.
And thank you for having me on.
Good night.